For those people who do not know me, my name is Maria Muradas Taylor, and I'm a Spanish lecturer here at the university. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Sam Helmet, not only in a professional manner, who inspires a lot of her students as well as a lot of her colleagues, but also as a friend who I've known for many, many years. She's actually my neighbor as well.
Can't get away from
it. Yes. Let me tell you just a little bit about Sam. So Sam works in phonology, focusing on stress and intonation, and in syntax phonology interface, with a special interest in prosodic properties of spoken Arabic dialects and language to, L2 learners of English. Her first degree was in Arabic and French from University of Leeds.
Oui.
Yes, very bien. And she's also taught English as a foreign language in the Middle East for a period of time. We don't know how long that period of time was, but how long?
2 years in Yemen.
Okay, very good. And after that experience, she decided to do a master's and a PhD in linguistics at the School of Oriental and African Studies at the University of London. And once again, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you, Salmet. Salmet. Sam. Okay, thank you.
So there'll be a brief pause because we're going to try and record the slides to go with the video. So. So thank you very much, and thank you for that very kind introduction, Maria. And for the invitation to the Language Teaching Forum, I must admit I've been sort of lobbying, saying, can I come? So I'm very, very pleased to be here. So my talk is about pronunciation matters, pronunciation matters. Does pronunciation matter? So that's what I'm going to try and talk out this afternoon. I thought I'd start with sort of full disclosure, really. So this is a video, one of the videos made by Heather Marsden's Mill Network. And it's my little story of my fun errors with Arabic pronunciation.
I was on my year abroad in Cairo, nearly 30 years ago. And I decided that I would drink tap water. It's perfectly safe in Cairo. And I needed to know the word to ask for tap water. I didn't know. I hadn't done much Arabic by the time I went out there. And somebody told me that it was Mayim and Al-Halafiyya. But I only heard this once from this friend. Thought I'd got that, what it was, go into a restaurant, order my plate of beans, bread. And could I have some Mayim Al-Halafiyya, please? Which is slightly different. Mayim Al-Halafiyya instead of Mayim Al-Halafiyya. And the waiter stared at me and said, harder, which is the Egyptian Arabic for, okay, and brought me some bottled water, because what I'd actually asked for was some fertile water instead of tap water. So I was on my year
old. Oh, stop it, stop it. We're going in a loop. So that's me experiencing the joys of a pronunciation error. Now, it's interesting because we're all... I'm going to just assume we're all language teachers here. If we are not all, at the moment, language teachers, we once were or we will be in the future, so, as well as language learners. And you could say, well, that's a vocabulary error on one level, but the point is that when I heard the word, Hanafiya, I misparsed it. And one of the things I'm going to talk about today is the fact that a lot of pronunciation errors stem from errors in perception at the point of trying to pick up what that word was. And the he difference in Arabic is a classic. So there's me on my year abroad. That is my Ain Shams University pass that I'm inordinately proud of and still keep in my little box of treasures. I had a lot of hair. What was that about? And so that was me. And well, this is sort of me now. And so this is a little paper I wrote a couple of years ago now, which is just a position paper. I just thought there's loads and loads of research on teaching pronunciation of English, because I guess on average, you know, if we counted up, more people in the world are learning English than other languages. Maybe that's not true, but there's certainly the impression you would get from the orientation of the research. So this was my attempt to try and turn it around and say, well, what would this look like if we were going to teach Arabic in a research evidence-based way? So if you're interested in that, you can find your way to it. But I guess some of what I'm talking about today is my journey from being a learner to a not via being a teacher of English, to being a researcher on the learning process. So this is what we're going to do today. I'm going to do two little talks. So one is a bit about, sort of a bit of teaching in a way, and those of you who are taking or will or have taken the second language phonology module, look surprised next time you see some of these slides, because I'm just using a little bit of that material from a master's module that we teach in the department about how we define pronunciation gain. How do you know if your pronunciation is better? And a bit of discussion on that. And then I've got two little bits of research that I've been done with students in this department, which I'm going to present to you, just sort of raw, the two studies. And I could have just done one of them for time, but one of them is good news and one of them is bad news. And I think we always need both of those to keep us realistic. So we're going to do that and then a bit more discussion time. So that's where we're going. So there's a break in the middle. You can refuel with biscuits halfway through. So pronunciation gain. So I am nevertheless going to keep this an interactive classroom, because otherwise I'll be bored, let alone you. So I'm going to get you to discuss with your neighbour. Just tell the person next to you, not me. What do you think the goal of pronunciation teaching might be? A second question I wanted to ask was, if you're a language teacher, do you actually ever do any pronunciation teaching? Do you manage to fit it in? Where, you know, but if you're doing some, what's the goal? What would you use? And then I will ask you your answers. 30 seconds, go. Another 10 seconds, then I'm going to stop you. We're done. It's done. Okay, these people are done. Excellent. Don't put that in the video. I need to learn how to do that. Excellent. These people are ready in group mode. They've circled the wagons back there and they're ready to serve the world. Okay. Would anyone like to say what your group said? What's the goal of pronunciation teaching? What did Dunstan say? Anyone want to volunteer an answer?
He said all we got to was the point where we said it might be good to strive towards neonative pronunciation, but it shouldn't be a kind of killer thing.
Okay. So there's somewhere out there is a goal that's about being native-like, but we have mixed feelings about that. Yes, another one?
I think it's important to inform learners of what the current pronunciation of the language target, which is, because so often their teaching materials are out of date, and so they're taught like archaic pronunciation.
For a year and a half, I taught students how to say, how do you do in Yemen? What was that about? I know I skipped that page. Exactly, yes. Yeah. So what version of the language are they learning? Yes?
Does it not depend upon the language?
For example, what the goal would be? Okay.
Yes. For example, in German, the word zahlen and zählen have two different meanings, like in row or row or bow and bow.
Okay, so if I'm going to reverse engineer that into my phonology speak, which is to say that in English, these two vowels might be really important to be able to tell the difference between them, but those two vowels might not be relevant for learning German. Yes, yes. That's exactly one of the things I'm going to be talking about. Yeah. Yes, they're, my goodness, I'm going to teach teachers or never teach students again. Yes.
Yeah, I was going to mention that whenever I do these exercises with students, I love these exercises. I think they're ever so much fun, but none of them likes them. They feel aggravated. They feel put upon.
So whatever the goal is, the process might be uncomfortable. Yeah. And there was one more, yeah?
Yeah, I think it's for me, it's an important part of the teaching. And I see as a tool also for students gaining confidence in inhabiting the language. And that's the result, the immediate result.
Yeah, thank you. And one more, yeah?
because striving for native life would make them feel like that they can't achieve that goal, and they will feel like desperate. Yeah, so.
And really, one, yes, excellent. We're all bringing out all the right points. Yes, Paul, really the last one.
I agree with that, but I can't measure intelligibility.
Okay. Good. So I think, yes, go on.
What we're saying, as long as we reduce the influence of their native language so that they can communicate effectively, and that as long as it allows them to communicate and not
okay, so, and I'm going to have a stop. Otherwise, I'll never get to the end. Go on, Dunstan. You just can't bear to not chip in.
Actually, I mean, if intelligibility is not geared towards some notion of a native speaker, which is highly problematic, we know that there are certain pronunciations which are easier for people to understand than others.
Okay.
They may not be native, but they.
Perfect. So this is perfect. You're saying all the things which are in the literature on this subject as the issues that we've got to decide how we're going to orient ourselves to them. And one of the things I meant to bring the book with me, and I've left it on my desk at home. There's a fantastic new book came out last year on all of these issues. And it's mainly written for the TESOL EFL market, but I think it's highly reverse engineerable for other languages. And there's a chapter on pronunciation instruction research, which is the sort of most classroomy one, and I could accidentally share a copy of that chapter with you if you were interested. And I guess the background to all of this is that I think the premise of this book, this is sort of the summary of the career of these two wonderful Canadian authors, to say pronunciation does matter. We should actually be focusing on it, but we need to work out what the goal is, because if you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time. We have to work out what we want to do. Certainly my experience as a language teacher was that pronunciation is often at the back of the queue in the fight for time in the classroom. That's not always the case, but and one of the things that Doering and Munro report is that teachers sometimes report not feeling very confident in how to do things. I'm not going to address all of those today, but I would recommend that book to you. It's in the library. One of the things that we end up thinking about is the idea of accent, foreign accent. And that was where we started, and then various people moved away from that being, you know, we start with trying to be native-like and moving away from that goal. It is true that listeners can usually detect an accent, and that we can usually detect if someone's a native speaker or not. The forensic people would point out that it's not always 100% reliable. People can put on a disguise relatively successfully. And if you get people to rate how native-like someone sounds on a scale of some kind, those ratings usually correlate with the things that we might think of as pronunciation errors. And we would make a distinction in the phonology world, the phonetics world, between segmental errors, so that's at the level of individual sounds, individual consonants and vowels, so substituting one sound for another, or deleting a sound altogether, or producing a sound in a funny way. And then we would also think about what you might call supra-segmental errors. So those are things to do with stress and rhythm and intonation. And that's, full disclosure, that's what I work on, so I'm a bit biased. That's the stuff I'm interested in. So if I rave about that, just wave at me. And a wacky piece of research showed that people could reliably identify accented speech played backwards from native-like, which suggests that there's a role somehow for something that isn't a property of this, it's like voice quality, that there are sort of home pitch values or voice quality values that go around with certain languages, which is an interesting point. I seem to have taken something out of that slide. So we end up with three sort of measures that are used in the literature. So is different speech, what we might call as variant from whatever the target is, is it necessarily difficult? And these are the three things that have exactly the three things that came up in your suggestions now. Is one is if you're accented, which is about how close are you to some norm, which might be a native speaker norm, it might be some other norm, but let's say, and it might be an old-fashioned norm or an up-to-date modern norm, but some norm. And then sort of the other end of the spectrum is intelligibility. Can you be understood? And somewhere in the middle is this concept of comprehensibility, which is how easy are you to understand? I can understand you, but it's exhausting and I'd really like to stop listening to you. Or I can understand you easily and I'd like to listen to you all day because you have a beautiful, whatever it is, accent. And distinguishing these is relevant for lots of things. Language teaching, which is what I'm going to talk a little bit about now, language testing and just social issues. I'm not going to talk about language testing at all because it's simply not my field. And it would be very interesting to think about the implications of all of this for assessment, but that may have to be for another day. But we're going to think a little bit about what the goal might be. So here are some actual definitions of this, which are the ones used in the literature. These are taken from a standard classic paper in the EFL literature. So intelligibility is the extent to which someone actually understood what was said. And the usual measure of that used in experimental work on, in this field is to ask the person to write down what they said. And we count the number of words they got right or something like that, or the number of segments they got right. Which I agree in the classroom isn't easy to do on the fly, but that's the measure that's used in the literature. And then foreign accentedness, people are asked to rate something according to a norm. So one is, I always get this scale reversed, one is native-like and nine is definitely foreign, whatever that is. And they are usually judging against an L1 community, not always. And then comprehensibility is this self-perception, self-sort of rating, I found that easy or difficult to understand. And we would use these very commonly in studies as dependent variables. There are other aspects of pronunciation which are really important, and perhaps the biggest of those is fluency. And I'm not going to talk about fluency today, again, not because I'm not interested in it, but because I've done less work on it, and I'm just beginning to include fluency measures in some of my studies. And there's a sense in which the fluency research and these measures have slightly developed separately, which is quite interesting in itself. So I'm not going to talk it, but that I'm very happy to talk about it in future when I've worked out what I think about it. So according to these quite influential folks in the EFL field, the goal of pronunciation teaching must be intelligibility. That must be your first goal. And that they're really strong on this. And that is something that would be interesting when you have a bit of time to talk again in your groups, how you feel about that. I think, broadly speaking, my inner language teacher says yes, but there's a little bit of a but as well, that there's something else to go with that. But certainly I would say intelligibility is the bottom line. And there's a very strong movement, which those of you who are professionals in the EFL world will testify to strongly argue that we shouldn't be forcing people to sound native-like, that it's fine to have an accent. There are many, many varieties of English, including accented varieties of English, and those are okay. And we end up with this concept which Jenkins proposed. She did her PhD at King's, and it was a very interesting corpus study of non-native speakers talking with other non-native speakers and working out what actually caused them to misunderstand each other. And those errors are the ones that we should worry about, because more people spend their time talking to other non-native speakers of English than they do to native speakers of English. And you end up with this lingua franca core, the core of English, which everyone in the world who speaks English as first, second, third, fifth, ninth language, whatever it is, all need to have to still be talking the same code to be understood. Nevertheless, all three of these measures do still get used in research, and you'll see some examples of them. But I would say that they're sort of multifaceted. I think sometimes we need more than one of these. They're also hard to interpret. So I'm going to just tell you about some classic studies. So this is an old one, but a good one. So it was the reading passages were taken from a standardized test used in the States from 11 different language groups, and they were rated by native US listeners. And then they made a count of the types of errors people made, and then they did a sort of correlation, you know, how, if you've got a strong accent, what type of error does that correlate with? And that is another word for these suprasegmental, stress, rhythm, intonation. And across all of them, all of the errors did correlate, although those of you who know your stats will know it's relatively easy to get a correlation of some kind. But the strongest one was these prosodic ones, so stress and rhythm and intonation. This is one of the papers that has said we should worry about that more than individual speech sounds. And if you want to know how I got into this kind of research, it's because I do this kind of stuff, and I think, oh, good, I'm important. I have something to offer. So this is another classic paper, and this is my, if you want to, you know, the picture tells a thousand words picture. This is a very nice plot. So this is a histogram, so the frequency plot of... There were five sentences produced by these learners. They were Chinese, Mandarin L1 speakers, learners of second language, learners of English. And for all of the language, all of the sentences that were transcribed on the intelligibility test, 100% correct, this is their scores for the accent. So everything on this chart was 100% intelligible. And yet there's a lot of variation between... Nobody sounded completely native-like, but there are people who were pretty good, low level of foreign accent to very high, definitely foreign. And what this shows is that accentedness and intelligibility are entirely orthogonal. You can be completely intelligible and have the thickest accent in the universe, and people can still understand you. And I guess that's what drives this idea that intelligibility is the goal. And a lot of the... I wanted to have a big picture at this point saying grandmother sucking eggs or something, because you know this, but to reassure you that it's discussed in the literature as well. Breaking it down, in that same study, they did some correlations of these different types of measures with different types of errors. So a phonemic error would be completely swapping B for P if you're an Arabic learner of English, something like that. A phonetic error is just having a funny, whatever it is, vowel. It's not wrong, but it's just produced strangely. An intonation error and grammatical errors. And interestingly, these sort of low-level phonetic errors have no impact on intelligibility, so we just, on one level, don't need to worry about them. And the correlation, this is the number of listeners for whom this was an issue, that it showed that this was a correlation with their rating. And it's pretty low for intelligibility. For accent, everything contributes, but the strongest one is intonation, but everything is pretty high. And then for me, the one that's very interesting is this comprehensibility measure, which is sort of how easy, how painful is it? I could understand you, but it was hard work. And the interesting thing in this study is that this intonation for these learners was a big contribution. And so the message here is that different types of error contribute differently to each pronunciation measure. And this kicked off a lot of statements in lots of literature, say, prosody, prosody, teach intonation, it's the thing to do. Kath, if you don't mind me highlighting you, is doing a master's in the department at the moment, has just replicated this study. So the original study was Chinese learners, Mandarin-speaking, L1 Mandarin-speaking learners of L2 English. It's replicated with L1 Emirati Arabic speakers learning English, and this completely disappears, this correlation. And which, if you think about it, might make sense, because the difference between a language with lexical tone switching into a language with intonation, whereas the prosodically Arabic and English have much more in common. So we need to temper a lot of these things by thinking about the specific languages we're looking at. And last but not least, just to show you some of the big claims out in the literature. So you may have come across this thing called the critical period hypothesis. Has anybody heard of that? So the idea that the ability to learn language drops away, or certainly, let's move it into the pronunciation domain, the ability to develop a native-like accent just drops away after puberty, let's say, around the age of 12, let's say. And this is a meta study looking at the results of sort of like a systematic review, lots of other studies, and then some modelling of it. But the upshot, the critical period hypothesis says that the older you are when you start learning, the stronger your global accent will be, and that there'll be a terrible sort of hard Brexit cliff edge or something in your accent. And you're just, you know, if you start a week after your 12th birthday, you're toast, you know, that's it. And in fact, that isn't a good fit to the data at all. At the same time, some people have argued that it's completely linear, that there's no effect of puberty, as it were, at all, that there's nothing going on. In fact, the best fit to the data is this sort of, it gets a bit harder, but it's not impossible, and then it does seem to get a little bit harder once you get into your sort of mid-20s. And lots of the theories, I'm not going to talk a lot about theory today, but if you want me to, I could. There are models and theories that try to explain these relationships. And instead of thinking that there is a biological effect, as it were, but the key of those theories is that the reason that it's harder to learn another language is because you've got one in the way. By that, you've really mastered your first language, and you're not still learning your first language anymore. You've stopped learning your first language, and it's really blocking that learning of the next one. So it's actually the first language which is just camping out like it's some toad or something in your perceptual system, blocking your ability to hear differences that you were able to hear when you were younger. And that can be overcome with training. Otherwise, there wouldn't be such a thing as phonetics. And we can hear the difference between these sounds. You just have to learn. The good news for us is that it is possible for pronunciation to improve. It's worth teaching. And I think one of the messages you sometimes hear that I have heard people say is, there's no point even doing research on pronunciation because there's no point teaching it because you can't improve after the age of 12, so why bother? And that's a myth, which we will dispense with. So it is worth. And there are some very nice studies showing completely native-like learners. I mean, there are some people who do better. So one of the things I'm interested in is, why do some people do better than others? There isn't so much research on second language phonology. There's much more on syntax. That's just the way of the world. There's just more everything on syntax than there is on phonology. And even less of it applies things to the classroom. But there isn't none, and I recommend that chapter in the book. But research could help us set realistic goals, i.e. not worry about native likeness, but something else. Set priorities, focus on the types of errors that really hinder intelligibility and or comprehensibility, whatever our goal is. And decide the focus. What sort of interventions help? Does explicit instruction help? And there's lots of people in education doing work on explicit instruction, although not of pronunciation. But that's and in fact, it does help, but not necessarily what you would expect. So there are some really nice studies showing that perception can really help. So the first of these, the Bradlow study, was a sort of online training. This was the Japanese learners of English getting R and L. And just having people train perceptually, their pronunciation, that no drills, no nothing, and they just learnt to hear the difference better, and there was a knock-on effect in their production. But we need many, many, many more studies to work out how this works and for other language pairs. Kazuya Saito, who gave a talk in the department at the beginning of term, who's at Birkbeck now, has some lovely research where he tried an intervention technique where he just got the teacher to do a recast. So instead of just saying, "Oh, that was wrong," picking up on error, whenever they picked up on the error, they always repeated it correctly, which you probably do anyway. But they just made a point of doing it in a systematic way that students got used to, and shows quite a strong effect of that, of a very simple modelling the right thing. So there are things that we can do, and doing the right thing rather than the wrong thing would help. I'm going to talk a little bit more about this before you give you a chance to talk to each other. For English, there are some people who've said what we think matters, what the priorities are. So I've just picked out two of the voices that have spoken on this topic. This Jenkins one is probably the more influential. And she is saying that what we're interested in is being understood by a non-native listener. And we should worry about, this is for English, so we should worry about the consonant inventory, get the consonants right, but we shouldn't worry about things like th or the, or sort of low-level phonetic detail. Some phonetic detail matters, some clusters, getting your clusters, vowels works, and sentence stress. In contrast, this study, which was for sort of the TESOL market in Australia, where the goal is to be understood by native Australian listeners, which arguably is a different setting, had actually this ordering and this order of priorities. So look at stress, word and sentence stress, syllable structure. And I wanted to highlight this concept of functional load. So there are some consonantal distinctions in English which do a lot of work in the lexicon. So there's lots of words where it matters if it's a s or a sh. And if you can't tell the difference between those, and they are quite difficult for some learners, then that's a contrast worth working on, worth getting right, worth producing accurately to be understood, worth being able to perceive. But that contrasts with the th and the one. And interestingly, th and the, I've seen headway pronunciation, I've seen the book, I've the drills, pages of drills on th and the. And yet the actual functional load of that in English is tiny, because there's a very big divide. You may have never thought about it, but almost all of the words with a the sound in it are function words. It's the, these, those, they. It's not all of them, but the majority. And it's a closed set. We're not making more the words. Whereas th sounds are almost all in content lexical words, like think and I can't think of any others. And so there's the functional load, the actual, that contrast, there's almost no words that differ in just those two. And the evidence base for that is based on just counting what we would call minimal pairs, which you may have come across. So the idea that pet versus pat shows us that air versus ah is a contrast. It makes a difference in English. And if you count the number of those, you get lots of minimal pairs for air and ah. You get hundreds and, you know, really, really frequent. The sounds themselves are frequent, and this contrast is present in all varieties of English. I think this one is still gone. So, whereas there are some contrasts between vowels in English which are simply not present in other dialects of English, and so native listeners of English can tolerate the lack of that contrast, so don't worry about it, arguably. Whereas there are completely unimportant contrasts, unless you're Scottish, I suppose, between ooh and oo. Which is relatively infrequent, entirely conflated by Scottish speakers, apparently. So, and very few minimal pairs. And yet you might again find drills. But you will find those in books on pronunciation for English equally, given equal weighting, and there's no logic to that. So my little paper I wrote on Arabic was a sort of trying to do this for Arabic. What's the functional load of different consonants in Arabic? And I can tell you that kh and h, khalafiyya, henafiyya, is very, very high functional load between those two. So I'm normal. Turns out I should have learnt my her and her earlier. So does accent matter? The last but not least, just to talk about the sort of issues thing. So here is where a bit of me thinks, well, it may be more than intelligibility matters. So there's some discussion in the study about discrimination towards that people with second language accents. The rise of a whole industry for determining where asylum seekers are from based on their accent, which is another discussion. There's an enormous industry of people helping people reduce their accent, especially for English. And also the fact that listeners can have a lot to offer this. So perhaps we ought to be training native listeners to be a little more, be able to tolerate the ambiguities of accents a little more. And then there's this nice paper by Hanson Edwards points out that sometimes most learners are going to be using the language and they may want to not just be intelligible but come off well in a job interview. Thank you very much and get the job. You know, some users will have higher goals. So, and there's a couple of papers that I just pulled out. So these are psychology sort of studies. But this one, for example, showed that in an experimental setting, the accented utterances were judged as being less believable, less credible than the native ones. And it was, if the listeners were then told, oh, well, you know, do you realise you were just biased in your listening, and listened again, the effect only disappeared for the accent, for the mildly accented ones. So if someone's got, so having quite a strong accent, even if you're intelligible, may cause problems. So, and last but not least, this is a lovely little study that was done in Heather's Nissel network. So this is interviews with our students in York. It was done in the summer of 2014. I've picked out German, I don't know why, for fun. I could have picked another one. All of the results are on. If you go to this website, you can see the results for different languages. And I asked for these questions to be included. So this is one saying, does accent, having a good accent matter to you? It's more important to be intelligible. This is comprehensibility. So I put those questions in to base, just to see what our learners actually think. And you can see that they both, all of these groups, think that they're important. These are the L1 English students learning German. And they are really key. They, all of them, I mean, these are probably not statistically significantly different from each other, but they're slightly higher for being understood. Whereas the non-native English speakers, so these are, I don't know what their first language would be, but they were also doing German, either on the degree or on LFA. And they were much, they were more interested in intelligibility. So they'd already, there may be a difference between English learners of other languages and others. These other ones, this is sort of to see if they think there's a lingua franca effect, because I'm not sure that holds when the target language isn't English, because fewer people in the world speak, are learning that target language. It may depend on the language and whether they think they need any teaching or not. And there's quite a lot of variation in that. One of my questions in the little paper I did on Arabic is whether the needs of English learners of other languages might actually be different from the needs of learners of English as a foreign language. That's sort of an obvious yes, they will be, but there's some quite nuanced thinking that might need to go into that. And that's just a little summary of those were the results in that survey for German, French, learners of those languages. And you can see that they are all saying intelligibility is more important than accentedness, but they're all saying comprehensibility is very important. And I think intelligibility is clearly the bottom line, but for many learners, I don't want to be hard work to listen to, is kind of important. At which point I'm going to stop and give you a chance to discuss. There's a little handout going to come around which has got these questions on it. I've pulled out four questions, and I don't mind which ones you discuss. So pick the one you're interested in your group. And I don't know what we're going to do with the answers to these questions other than let's hope we find some solutions. Does pronunciation matter? What extent? What's the goal? Coming back to that one. To what extent are you able to align with that goal in your day-to-day practice? And answering that question about whether the needs of your learners might be different from the learners of English if you're teaching not English, yeah? And we've got at least until 10 past. Is that all right? So good 5-10 minutes? And then I will get you to tell us what you thought.
And disagree on the kind of, it's difficult when you get older. It's a question of how you surround yourself.
So, are any of those questions scratching you where you actually itch, as it were? Which of those are closest to issues that you deal with day to day? Anybody want to volunteer? What did you actually discuss? Does pronunciation matter?
Yes. Absolutely.
Yes. Most people are saying yes. Some people are saying yes. Phew, I'll carry on then. Yeah, so. I'm not sure I know the answers to these, but I think some of these are the right questions to be asking. And I think the answers may depend. A lot of the answers are going to be, it depends. And your learners in front of you will have different needs. And we may need to adjust. So I'm going to plough on. And I'm going to... talk a little bit about some of the research that I've done with students in this department. And there's quite a few different studies I could have chosen from. So I've picked two. And I've picked one which is good news and one which is bad news. It's not terrible news, but it may come as a surprise news. And then I've got one which is slightly better news. And these are, you know, full-on little bits of research. So if at any point there's some concept which I think is clear but I've forgotten to explain, then do just interrupt me in the middle and say, what on earth does that mean? And we'll review that. So this, the first one I'm going to show is a little... these are both talks that I gave at a conference in the summer, which is the big sort of every 3 years... international conference on second language phonology, and Kath was there, so sorry to show you a picture, Kath. This is joint work with this person, Florence Edwards, who some of you may recognise was a student in our department. And this study was actually a study she did for her sort of final year undergraduate dissertation type project. And it's we're looking at the contribution of study abroad. Have you spent some time in a German-speaking country or not, versus individual differences in phonological working memory, which I'll unpack, on the development of having a good accent. So here our measure we're using is how good your accent is. For better or worse, we're actually looking at accentedness. And this is in the context of quite a bit of research has been done on the contribution of the year abroad, study abroad, to accent. And it's quite variable. And most of the studies have looked at the influence of what we might call learning context factors, so things like how long you spent, how much of your time you spent talking with native speakers rather than your housemates who are also English, your motivation, those sorts of things. There is some very clear and good work on fluency effects of the year abroad, which is a separate study has a more positive story to tell, actually. So fluency really does develop on the year abroad, but we're looking at accent. So this study was just a very first exploration of the potential contribution of individual differences in cognitive abilities. So what the learner brings in their just cognitive system, their whatever, I don't know. We're looking specifically at phonological working memory. So phonological working memory is your ability to, how much of a string of noises can you hold in memory? How long a string do you reliably, and how much detail in that string do you reliably retain? And some people have stronger or weaker phonological working memory. It's a thing you can measure. And I think it might be a proxy for what we think of as someone having a good ear. So you will all know, I knew in my classroom, that there are some people who just hear when you say the word and they pick it up right away. There are people who are good mimics. I'm hopeless. When I worked in sales, I was always doing the accent of the person I was selling to down the phone, because I accommodate to the other person sort of without really thinking about it. So I think I might have a good ear, whatever one of those is, and it may go around with having a good phonological working memory. So it's a tiny study. It's what we call an apparent time study. So we're measuring people before and after the year abroad, but we're measuring them all at the same time. So we measured some students who had done a year abroad and some who hadn't, all measured at the same time. It's not the perfect design, but it's the one you can do in one summer if you're an undergraduate doing a dissertation. And they are L1 English-speaking students of L2 German in our department, before and after their year abroad. So the research question is, we're going to measure their phonological working memory. We're going to see whether it interacts with or outweighs other factors, such as these sort of learning context factors. And the measure of pronunciation gain we're using is this degree of accent. In fact, Florence used a kind of mushed combination scale that combined accentedness and comprehensibility. And we're looking at this because there is nice evidence to show that phonological working memory does improve your ability to process sound. So you can lodge the L1 toad off your perceptional system slightly better if you have stronger phonological working memory, if that's a helpful analogy. The other thing that might be good about it is that it may be something that could be learnt, could be trained. You could improve in sort of brain jogging type things. So we had 12 students in our department. And six hadn't yet done their year abroad, and six had done their year abroad, so the before and after groups. One of them turned out to be a bilingual, so that's this person, 1.2, and you'll see them in the score. So their accent in German was pretty good, and that may be partly to do with their knowledge of Swedish. And they were rated, they recorded Nordvind und Sonne, which is a classic sort of thing we have people read, and then their... those recordings were played to native German listeners. Thank you. Some people here might have listened to those and rated them and said how native-like the accent was. And then we collected a bunch of information in a questionnaire about what they'd done on the year abroad. And then we made them all do this non-word repetition task. So they hear some made-up words like kajabloggadoodle or something, and then they have to repeat it. And it's can they repeat? And they go from 4 to 7 syllables long. So some of them are really long. And some people, you make mistakes quite quickly. And it's a standard test in the literature. So if we look first at how accented they were, so this is a measure of the green ones here are the before group and the after group. And low numbers are having a strong accent, being hard to understand. High numbers are being native-like, being easy to understand. And you'll see that there are some people at the top of the scale in both groups. So, in fact, the best person was in the before group, and that's probably this... it's this person here, the Swedish bilingual. So we may want to sort of set her aside. If this were a bigger study, we might pull that person out of the study. But the interesting thing is that the distribution of scores from native-like, hard, easy to understand... non-native-like, hard to understand, is pretty much the same in the two groups. So you can see already that having spent at least one semester in a German-speaking country, in principle, doesn't have a big impact on your accent. And this is the actual individuals, and you can see that... So these six here, these are the ones who've yet to go on the year abroad, and they're sort of at all the difference. This person's bad, this person's good... all the places in between. And you have the same in the other group. So this person is good and this person is bad. And obviously the study we would like to do is what you would call a longitudinal study where you measure the same people before and after, which we'd like to do. And we applied for the money to do it last summer and we didn't get it, but we will apply again. So because that would be a fantastic study to really map it. This is a correlation plot. So here along... the up and down, you've got the same thing as here, yeah, strong to weak. And this is plotted against how old they were when they started learning German, the importance of them in the questionnaire, if they say, I want to have a good accent or not, whether that matters to them, and their self-rating of how much they participate in class. These crazy lines show you that wiggling all about is telling you no relationship between these two variables. And the red dots are... The finalists and the black dots are the second years. There's a slight, looks like there's a bit of a correlation here. It means there's a bit of an upward trend, so it may be. It's a weak relationship, so wanting to have a good accent shows some effect, but not much. These for the finalists, absolutely no relationship with how long they spent in the German-speaking country. Or how much their self-reported use of German was while they were away, and or even their measure of how confident they feel learning German. All those things that we would hope might correlate. The one that really correlates is their phonological working memory, regardless of whether they've done the study abroad or not. And there's a sense in which that's sort of obvious, because there are some people who just have a good accent and some people who don't. And it may be... And I don't know that this is real new research and I don't know the answers. And I would be very interested. One of the reasons I wanted to talk in this setting is because I would much rather develop future research with input from people who are actually teaching this. Maybe we shouldn't be teaching pronunciation. Maybe we should be helping people improve their phonological working memory because then their pronunciation will improve. I don't know. I don't know if it's that stark, but maybe it is. But there is a strong correlation. If you've got a good ear, you have a good accent, regardless of whether you've had... So it's almost as if... We know from other studies the year abroad is fantastic for all sorts of other things. I'm not putting down the year abroad, not least fluency. But this is just about having a native-like accent. So the results say no direct relationship between, you know, the pure act of going to Germany won't give you a good accent, which we kind of knew, but there you go, we've proved it. Even if you think having a good accent is really important, but phonology and working memory is quite important. In this little sample, there wasn't an improvement in their fluency, but it is a tiny sample, and that has been shown in other studies. So that was that study, which was sort of bad news in a way, because you could say, why do a year abroad? No, you just need a good ear, you're toast, whatever. But what I hoped we would find was that the people with a good ear got more out of the year abroad, or the others caught up or something like that. And so it really would be worth doing a longitudinal study so we can plot that with, but we need large numbers of students. We need to track students constantly over a period of several years to build up a corpus that's big enough. So that's that one, because it might be trainable. Would you like the good news? Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to tell you something which is an unexpected byproduct of learning a language that won't surprise you either. So this is another study. It's done with Becky Morales-Taylor, who's at York St. John, and Bethany White, who did her MA in psycholinguistics in the department. This was part of her MA dissertation. And this is an analysis of stress deafness, which I will define, in English listeners. Someone's met an English person and knows that we're deaf to stress. The subtext is that in this, learning Spanish turns out to help you with learning Japanese. So I'm going to talk about stress in English. And we know that there are a small number of stress minimal pairs in English, so present and present. And there are other ones, so conduct, conduct. There aren't many of these, but they're often noun-verb alternations. But there are enough that people think they're a thing. There's so many. There's actually very few of them in English. Object and object, etc. And one of the things I'm interested in here is actually the phonetics of these things. So moving into quite a fine-grained way of thinking about them. So here is my recording of the word object.
Object, object.
In my best Marks and Spencer's voice, apparently, object. And this is object.
Object, object.
And one of the things I'm interested in is what happens to, in that first syllable, what happens to the vowel? So we know that in English, an unstressed vowel will very frequently undergo a thing we call vowel reduction. So we say object. We don't say object, object. It's object. We would reduce that vowel. And other things being equal, we mark stress in English by the strong syllables being higher in pitch, longer in duration, louder, and the weak syllables are lower in pitch, shorter, quieter, and crucially, they have this extra cue in English, sort of telltale cue of squashing the vowel down to the schwa vowel. It doesn't happen in every unstressed syllable, some resist it, but it's very common. However, we know that stress behaves differently in different languages, and the marking, the way you mark stress is different. Stress can be in different places in the word in different languages, and crucially, they have different phonetics. Stress in French, who is these people? No, they are they're almost history already. We have. They are already. He's no more, but he hasn't gone yet. So we have, who is this? Hollande. And? Nice final stress. He's not Sarkozy or even Sarkozy. He is merci Sarkozy. Okay, so French, the stress is always at the end. Yes, Hollande, Sarkozy. And I noticed that some BBC announcers that get that right, they say, and Sarkozy is coming. So Sarkozy. So stress in French is always at the end. And interestingly, when they were asked to perform a psycholinguistic, you'll see the test, it's quite artificial, but it's an experiment. If you ask French listeners to listen to made-up pseudo-Spanish nonsense words with Spanish stress, they can't do it. I'm sorry, but they can't. So they perform very badly in this stress-based memory task. And this was true even after they were this advanced learners of Spanish. So French people who'd learned Spanish to a very high level, some of them had been in Spain for years, Spanish spouse, super, super fluent, still can't hear the stress in this experiment. And this was called stress deafness. There's a classic paper called Stress Deafness in French Listeners. Why? Why would this be? Nothing wrong with being the, it's nothing cognitive. And as we saw, the reason is that in French, we've just seen it, stress does not move around in French. It's always at the end, yeah? It's always on the last syllable. So there's absolutely no reason in French to learn where the stress goes. So the theory is that when you build in your mental lexicon where you store your representations of words, one of the things you don't bother storing in that representation is where the stress goes, because why would you? Because it's always on the end. You can put the stress in. And arguably, actually, it goes further than that. There isn't actually any stress at the word level in French at all. It's all the property of the phrase. So there just is nothing. There's the word, you've got your word in there. You say, oh, I need the word Sarkozy, pull it out. Bad stress, no, nothing. So there's no need to store in your memory where the stress is in French. So when you're listening to stress, you've got a large no-stress toad sitting of your L1 system blocking your willingness, ability to hear stress. And that, interestingly, wasn't overcome by learning Spanish. So the fact of learning, which Spanish has stress, it matters where you put it, and that didn't help. So we wanted to do a study on stress deafness in English listeners. Now, why on earth would we do that? So there's, based on that theory of why French listeners were found to be deaf to stress, there's no expectation that English listeners would be deaf to stress, because stress does move around in English. We just saw some minimal pairs. Nevertheless, and this was partly how the work started with my co-author Becky, is that her PhD thesis showed that English learners of Japanese have a lot of difficulty in acquiring the accent system, which is the equivalent of word-level stress in Japanese, and just were putting accents pretty much anywhere. And you may also, in your experience, have come across English learners having difficulty with stress in the language you teach. There's another paper in the literature that shows that English learners of Polish have trouble getting the stress right, even though Polish stress is quite simple. And our hypothesis was that the phonetics matter. So this business of exactly this phonetics, and specifically this vowel reduction cue, would matter. So we did two little studies. The first question is, we're asking, is, are English listeners deaf to stress? Let's just replicate that study that was done with French listeners and get some English people to do it and see how they do. Replication is really important in the social sciences because we need to show, Kath's just replicated that older study, and you get a different result. If we want to get the same result, if the study's right. So our prediction on this is, in fact, that they are going to have a problem with stress because we think the phonetics matters. And the second one was, can this be overcome? And we think that because the issue for English listeners is the phonetics, it's not this business of whether you store it or not, it's whether you perceive it, whether you hear it in the first place accurately, that we think that once people have learnt Spanish, they will overcome it and do better. So the monolinguals will behave like the French, but then they will improve having learnt, which is, so we will, it will be non-persistent. Does that make sense? Yeah, so I did the first part with Becky, and she designed the experiment, and then Bethany reran it with some advanced learners of Spanish. So the test is this one. It's called a sequence recall task, and it was used in the French studies, and it's designed to test whether you can store stress in your working memory. Not whether you can just hear it, but whether you can store it, make use of it. And this is the one the French listeners couldn't do. And the task is to learn a pair of words. So you have, they sound like this.
Nama, nama.
And you may recognize that's Richard Ogden, who produced all of our stimuli for us. Thank you, Richard. So you have these two words, nama and nama. And that's word one and word two, and the whole experiment is just those two words. So it's pretty divorced from reality, in a sense. But nevertheless, you get a clear result. And this is how they do it. So they have to learn the words. They're shown the two words. It's all done on a computer. Word one and word two. And then they have to recognize them. Was that one or two? And if they get it right 7 times in a row, then they're allowed to go on and do the rest of the experiment. And then they get a practice where they hear just two.
Nama, nama.
And they have to say, was that one, then two, or was it two, then one? Which was it? Have you learnt it?
Nama, nama.
one, then two. Yeah? Okay, so that's easy. Lull you into false sense of security. And then they get the real test where they have four words, and the task is to say, was it word one, then two, then one, or two, then one, then two? And it's speeded. Okay?
Nama, 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 nama.
Okay.
We're all feeling better for the French people now. So this is difficult. Okay, I'm going to play it once more, which you wouldn't get in the test. What do you think the sequence is? And that okay at the end, which is my voice doing my Martin's okay, is deliberately to stop you using pure acoustic memory. Because we cut in, you can't, it blocks your ability to just do it on rerunning the acoustics in your head. So which one is it?
Nama, 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 nama.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, it was 2-1-2-2. It's lots of people completely reversed them. That's right. So you would have had more training. So that's the test. And the thing we're measuring is accuracy and their ability to do this. And they get 20 of them, and then we see how they do. Now, we manipulated the cues to these. And Richard produced these for us. This is, again, a replication of what happened in the Spanish-French study. So this is the ones you've just heard, which are English-like.
Nama, nama.
So we're using all the normal cues with pitch and loudness and duration, but you've crucially got that vowel reduction. So it's nama. Yeah, so you get the vowel reduction. Here is what it would be like in pseudo-Spanish.
Nama, nama.
So it's nama, nama. No vowel reduction. And here is what it would be like in very botched pseudo-Japanese.
Nama, nama.
And this is Richard's work very hard to take out. The only differentiation there is pitch. There's no differences in loudness or duration or vowel reduction, so which is what you get in Spanish, Japanese. Okay? So we've got these three pseudo-languages, and we've got our monolingual English listeners. So for the we had... 12 in each group, 12 listened to this, 12 to this, and 12 to that. And we compared them. And then Bethany collected data with a group of English people who had advanced Spanish. And they did all three tests each time. We couldn't find so many of those people to run them on. So we're going to look at the results now. So the sort of orangey-pink colour is the monolinguals. And the blue is the advanced learners who've got good Spanish. And this is their error rate. So 20 is you got all of them wrong. And 0 would be getting none of them wrong. And guessing, I guess, would be somewhere in the middle. I don't know. But yeah. So if we look at this, if we look at the monolinguals first. So these were just, we recorded this, did this on campus. It was just staff and students at the University of York. And we monitored how much language learning they'd done. So no one here had anything past GCSE in any language. And the ones who listened to Japanese did very badly. So the average error rate is about 18, and it was very bad. I think there were 28 trials. So, yeah. So they do very, very high error rate. Nevertheless, if you give them the English-like stimuli, they do fine. Now, remember, the task itself is quite difficult, so everybody makes a few errors, even when they're listening to English, but they're pretty low. And the Spanish ones were intermediate, the ones who listened to, like, the pseudo-Spanish. So taking away that vowel reduction cue does cause a difference, and this difference is statistically significantly different between those two groups here. So it's enough. It's a problem. But Japanese was super hard. If we compare that with the people who had already learnt Spanish, so they behave when they were listened to the English stimuli the same as the monolinguals did, which you would expect. That's our prediction, is that if you play us something that sounds English, we won't have a problem with it, as English phonetics. But interestingly, their error rate in Spanish is pretty much the same as it is in English. So their advanced knowledge of Spanish has entirely erased that difficulty that the monolinguals had with Spanish stress, which is good news. Hooray. And what's interesting is that they were also very much better with Japanese, even though they've never heard any Japanese in their lives before. And that, I would say, is probably the most... We were looking for this, and this is the one we're excited about, anyway. Now, I know that probably as a language teacher, that's sort of obvious, because we know that learning one language... People who've learnt one language do better at learning another one. That also goes around with those theories of language learning that say that the issue isn't that you're past 12, you're toast. The issue is that you've got to get past the L1 filter that you've built up, and you've got to get past that to learning other languages. Once you've done that once, it's easier to do it again. So the bad news is, yes, English listeners are stress deaf if you give them the wrong phonetics. But the good news is that the process of language learning, something in that process means that they overcome it, which is really good news. And what another cool thing is that the English learners of Spanish, we made them do the phonological working memory test. And the ones who have good phonological working memory had advanced even more. So that's a significant factor in the model, is that they're pulling away even further from the rest in the group, because so there's some advantage of that. So having learned to deal with the new cues to stress that they have to deal with in Spanish, i.e. something other than vowel reduction, these learners generalize the skill to a new language. So learning Spanish can help you with Japanese. That's the fun short byline. And then in terms of theory, this supports models where what you're really doing is inhibiting your first language to get on to others, rather than actually you have to, every time you learn a new language, you start from scratch. And this is another piece of evidence supporting that, which is, again, good news for anyone who's learnt more than one language will know that's true. So practically, what we'd really like to do is a longitudinal study of learners of Spanish in our department to track this process through as it goes through. And that's the one that Maria and I put in a bid for some funding for in the summer, and we'll try again to see if we can get that. So, does anyone have any questions about either of those little studies? I meant to put a questions thing there at that point. No? One thing that you... Yeah, go on.
For the students who studied abroad, have you taken into account if they interact with native speakers? If they interact with native speakers when they were abroad?
Yes, that was one of the factors that we measured that didn't have a correlation. Didn't. No.
Wow. Why?
This is for accent, remember? This is for how... this isn't about how fluent they are or how much their grammatical accuracy improves. This is just on how German-like they sounded. It would be one semester, yeah.
Yeah, you couldn't.
It may not be long enough, no, yeah.
If you take somebody who before they go off and then they come back, you might find differences.
We might do, yeah. Yeah. There are many reasons to do a better study, yeah. We can see. Dom, yeah.
Yeah, the six scatter plots that you showed, the second of those with the regression line that suggested a positive correlation between. Reinforcing effect of being told by native speakers that you have a good accent, because good accent is quite often taken as a proxy for other aspects of language competence. So I've been told that when I lived in Germany that my accent was good, although my fluency was really low, that people assumed I was better at speaking German than I actually was, and that encouraged me to
Okay. Where were we now? So I think those are very good points, and clearly there's much more we should do. The question I was going to get you to discuss in your second discussion point, and this is where I'm making you ask questions that I'm interested in. So you may just go, we don't want to play. There are three areas in second language phonology research which are really hot topics at the moment. And I would be interested to know what you think of them as questions. So one of them is our desperate need for longitudinal studies that track the learning process rather than just a snapshot in time, which only tells you so much, to really track the relative contribution of learning environment, learning all the input factors and these individual differences, cognitive distances. So if we did a longitudinal study in our department, would you be willing to play, I guess is the question. Can we play with your students? Could you see any other side effect benefits of that for you as teachers, us as the department? What would you be interested in us investigating along the side? Because while we're bothering to collect data, what other data would be interesting to collect? What are your views on this contribution of individual cognitive differences? I think there might be some ethical sensitivities around that to think about and how we look at that in the classroom. Another one is, what about teaching interventions? What kind of, would you be interested in doing something that really looked at, if we try this on these students, should we do like a randomized controlled trial where we deliver one kind of pronunciation training of some kind with some students? You always have to do those things so that everybody gets the training in the end, but you have a control group, and that can be done. Any other research you'd like to do? So I'm going to throw those questions at you. I thought I'd take much longer to explain those things. And then we'll have a good sort of 10 minutes at the end to discuss those points and then anything else that comes up. Thank you. There's no beer at all. So my laptop is about to conk out, so I did do some questions. And I'll say my thank yous now to Heather and the networks and my co-authors. And then before my laptop completely switches off, which of these would anyone like to do?
Yeah.
All of these, yes. Do you want to say something?
No, number three.
Number three, teaching interventions.
Yes.
Everybody wants to do teaching interventions. Okay, they want to do everything. Excellent. So what sort of teaching interventions would you want? So this is related to pronunciation would be my thing. I'm not against all the other skills. They're really good, but I do pronunciation.
Looking at kind of having, I guess in class it wouldn't really work or it'd be an extraordinarily boring class, but like high variability, high volumes and like perceptual training. Because people have done it in the lab setting, but no one's really looked at how that.
Yes. So HVPT is a thing. It's high variability pronunciation training or perception training. And one of the contributions of that is that the high variability is that it's more at this training, say, on R and L. That's my laptop switching off. One of the Japanese learners learning R and L, they do better if they hear the targets in lots of different voices. Because if you hear it with the same voice every time, you just clue into the acoustics of that voice and you never bother to build this representation, which is what we need to do. We need a representation that reliably helps us. Oh, that was one of those. We need a cloud of things that we classify together as being the same thing. It's true. It's mainly just done in the lab. That would be cool. I think you'd have to... Someone was saying, when would you fit this into the classroom time? What would you take out of the current curriculum to slot this in instead?
In the classroom, it would have to be something parallel to it.
I think you can. And I was saying there was a very nice study. This was learners of English and on a grammatical construction where they set them homework, which they had to do communicatively in a chat room. Mm-hmm. And all of their chats were recorded with their prior consent. And the study was on the evolution in their increasingly accurate use of this construction because of the task they were set, which they had to use it. Now, how you would do that in a pronunciation setting, I don't know, but yeah. Dom.
Well, that's good that Ruth's been involved in delivering the phonetics of a modern language module, the final year module.
Sorry.
What's your take on the effectiveness or the utility
A lot of the Spanish students that have taken it in the past, the one thing they say to me is that it would have been good for them to have done something similar in year two. Mm-hmm.
So year two, before they go on the year abroad, so they can actually assess their pronunciation before and after, and also to be conscious about what are the things they need to work on when they're in the year abroad. That's the feedback I got from students.
Does it tend to be the case that students who opt to do that module are ones who are already interested in pronunciation? Or is it ones who think, well, crikey, I'm just about to graduate and I can hardly make myself understood in speaking French?
I think it's quite mixed. I mean, you have students who are keen in pronunciation, but then I had, I can only speak for Spanish. Students who, they've been to exotic, let's put it, different parts of Spanish-speaking countries with very distinct, different accents or pronunciations, and they just want to analyze their, and do a comparison between Castilian Spanish, whatever they consider standard, and then Colombian Spanish or Mexican Spanish. So it's more, for some it's an interest, sort of almost like a social linguistic interest, and other ones because they're really keen on phonetics, so.
Maybe I shouldn't say that, but I had one student last year who actually did the module, but did do the year abroad, and our first thought was, oh my God. Well, actually, the way I worked with her, fortunately, I had only two students, but the way I worked with her, at the end of the day, what she produced, the last recording was very, very good. She got it very easy. And the improvement from the first take to the final take was actually very different. So I'm not saying that, so in terms of accent, it did improve, and also the rhythm and the stress, and everything improved, although she was especially abroad.
The thing that's interesting to me about teaching accent and pronunciation in the class is, like I was telling in my group, I think it's quite political. By what is, we talk about, people think that there's a certain type of accent that is the proper accent. And I'm of the belief that, well, that's not true. I mean, Spanish has 21 different countries that speak Spanish, and with that, there's multiple variations of Spanish. And the problem is when you have purists who believe that only one type of accent is the correct accent. And I think that could be, when it comes to pronunciation, that could be quite political. Mm. And I think that we need to go beyond that stereotype that there's only one proper accent when it comes to languages, because how can I deny Chilean accent? I have my colleague from Chile here, and say, well, sorry, but, yours is not Iberian accent, and Iberian accent actually from Castilla, because that would be considered the pure, blah, 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 blah. So, I mean, I think that, I find that with colleagues in the past, there's this attitude of, well, there's only one type of accent that should be the correct accent. Well, not really.
That's perfectly fine. And Sam, my colleague here, he has an Austrian accent and it's beautiful too. Not he, just the accent, obviously. Of course, that's but there is a difference. You can discern whether somebody is a foreigner.
But
still,
I think
although
or a learner.
That drops out. So tests have shown that Americans can't let's say you've got some second language learners of English who've been learning varieties of British English, different varieties of British English. And if those are rated by British listeners, you get one set of ratings. If they're rated by American listeners, they are more tolerant of the accent because they think, well, it may just be a funny British accent. So it could be native-like because they haven't the target is more narrowly defined. So there are possibly lessons to learn there from because there has been a big political discussion in the EFL literature and a very strong movement away from there being one norm. That's gone. There isn't one norm anymore in English. So, yes, Chris.
I agree with what Maria said. I think this is very political. And because of that is why for many learners, learning pronunciation is so important, because it's about your identity.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's rather patronising to assume that our learners simply want elocution and to sound like a sort of backward received pronunciation.
Yeah.
I think the self-confidence and also that modulation of your identity within your own language and between languages, you need that sense of control of to what extent you're speaking from from your own roots and to, what, to what extent you're transcending those in a kind of sort of international or kind of national English. So I don't think it's a kind of snobbery to want to learn how to control the instrument of pronunciation. It's because it's so important to establish your own identity and your own place within that.
Yep.
Just a bit of an anecdote for EFL on the end of this. Just something I remember, and it's got no research significance, but I remember we had a phonetician who used to work in CELT, and he did intensive pronunciation, 2 hours a week, for 8 or 9 weeks. And what was interesting was, I observed him on about week 9, and there were still 20 people there. It was like they were turning people away at the doors, and it was just the great interest in attending a pronunciation class from somebody who really knew the subject.
Mm.
And I was quite humbled by it.
I think many learners care about their pronunciation, and they will all have different goals. But so us as teachers, we have to somehow, as with everything else, try and modulate what we do in the classroom to that. Thank you very much for your rapt attention. It's been fun. Thank you.